eBay Motors is here for the ride. Elbow grease and a whole lot of love transformed 100,000 miles and a body full of rust into a drive entirely its own. LED headlights, spoilers, whatever you need. eBay Motors has it at affordable prices. And with eBay Guaranteed Fit, it's guaranteed to fit your ride every time. Keep your ride or die alive at ebaymotors.com. Eligible items only. Exclusions apply.
Good morning, good afternoon, and good night, and welcome to T-Pain's Nappy Boy Radio Podcast, the most fun you'll ever listen to while you're folding your clothes. Now let's get this straight, this is not your average podcast. T-Pain's Nappy Boy Radio is super fun, super crazy, it's pretty much an in-your-face conversation. That's the good thing about us, we don't do interviews, we do conversations. All of my guests, all of my co-hosts, we chill, we drink, we play games, we have the song of the week, we have the creative curse word of the week, as long as you're having fun as our guest. Speaking of guests, each week I'm going to go through my whole contact list and dive headfirst into the world of music, gaming, exotic cars, tech, strippers probably, doctors probably strippers that are only stripping so they can pay for tuition to become a doctor. You never know. My wife is a certified bartender. She'll make you a drink while you're here. We'll get you drunk and make you play VR after. It's a lot going on, but that's what it's all about over here at T-Pain's Nappy Boy Radio Podcast. See you soon, baby!
You know, I got to tell you, I have so many garbage apps on my phone, I never know where to look for stuff. And recently, I decided to clean house. All the junk and clutter gone. This leaves me with my most cherished apps. You know, the ones that can do it all. Like my Live One app. Music, events, news, podcasts, comedy. Oh, and actual musical stations curated by humans, not those robots hanging out on Bezos' yacht. All this on one tiny little place on my phone. I've become such a fan of the app, we here at the Adam Carolla Show will give you 3 months free. Jump on to liveone.com/Carolla to lock in your deal today. And with inflation at an all-time high, this is a huge savings. liveone.com/Carolla for 3 months plus for free. No ads.
Hello, welcome to CarCast. I'm Matt, the moderator, DeAndre, here with Bill Goldberg.
Happy New Year to you,
Happy
buddy.
Happy New Year. Yeah, it's been kind of a whirlwind couple of weeks for us, for a lot of people. I just want to I guess let's just start right away with mentioning Ken Block. What a horrible, tragic accident. Ken Block passing, 55 years old. I don't know. I don't really know all of the details around it. Apparently, he was on a snowmobile, I think out with a few friends at the time. He was alone on the snowmobile. Something happened. He got underneath it. And however he ended up there, it is absolutely terrible. I can't imagine what his family is going through. So my condolences to them. I really feel for them. You know, we haven't done a ton with Ken Block, but over the years, we definitely have done stuff. Like we've been, you know, we were all there for Goodwood, and we, you know, filmed a TV commercial with him. I think for Forza Motorsport, and he's on CarCast a few times over the years, some of our early years, almost 12, 13 years ago, before we even built out the new studio and everything. You know, Ken Block came by the studio and stuff. So, you know, we had this very nice kind of cordial relationship on and off over the past decade or so. And to see what he has done, you know, for himself, for his companies, for his family, for the car community, is just phenomenal. And I don't know, you know, this comes up all the time. Like, hey, Adam Carolla, you were the first to do podcasting. And he's like, well, I don't think I was the first. I was just sort of the first to maybe do it a little bit more mainstream. Or to do it and start gaining a lot of attention to the podcasting world. And I feel like Ken Block has done so much for the motorsports world with his content creation, his marketing ability, building a company around what he has done, a successful brand around it. The Gymkhana videos were really the first of their kind. Everyone's tried to emulate that. I mean, a lot of people successfully have done it. They sort of paved the way for it. And he did it with open arms. I mean, conversations that I've had with him were always about, you know, like how he's got there. And then he's just like, let's just do it. Let's just do more. Let's just keep going bigger and better. And what are you guys doing? What's happening in podcasting? What is, you know, like he was just so interested in creating content for that world that was kind of fun. And I appreciate all of that, not just as an enthusiast, but as a business owner.
Yeah, I mean, first and foremost, obviously, my condolences go out to his family. I can't even imagine what they're going through. I look at Ken Block like Tony Hawk. He revolutionized the sport completely. Yeah. You know, Tony Hawk did it in skateboarding. Ken Block did it, I think, maybe times 10. He did things. He was a patriarch. He was indicative of how the X Games community and the X Games kind of revolutionized and changed motorsports. I mean, before him, there was Evel Knievel, right? Evel Knievel pushed the envelope every time he went out. Man, Block did things. Remember the first backflip we saw on a motorcycle?
Yeah.
He did things that were revolutionary like that, like each time he went out. It was pretty unbelievable, the benchmark that he set. And, you know, I crossed paths with him many times. And to be such a trendsetter and to be so revolutionary, he was just a down-to-earth dude, too, which is really cool to see. So – heart goes out to his family. You know, this guy's done so much motorsports wise and he goes out and something happens on a snowmobile. So it was a crappy way to start the year off. Look at Monday Night Football. You know,
we're all hoping
and praying for him right now. And, I mean, what we saw, I mean, it happened on national television. What has happened in the past in football, whether it be in the NFL or in college, when it came to, you know, ambulances coming out on the field, having to tend to players that were hurt. Never before did you see anything like you saw at Monday Night Football this last week, because it all happened in real time.
Right.
So
yeah.
It opened a lot of people's eyes and, you know, thoughts go out to he and his family. And it just, you know, it's a crappy way to start the year off, and it really makes you look inside yourself. And it's a trying time for sure. So hopefully 2023 will go a hell of a lot better than it started. But it's a really, really crappy way to start the year. And then you got who's the actor?
Jeremy Renner. Yeah.
Jeremy Renner. You know, I guess it comes in threes, right?
I guess. And there's been more in the motorsports world as well. Jeremy Renner, an actor from movie SWAT and the Avengers
the Marvel product.
Yeah, he was driving a snowcat, I think, a big probably not too far out from Steve Austin and Aaron Hagar. He's up in that kind of Reno, Nevada, Tahoe area. And apparently the story was he had this big tractor, the snowcat, and he was helping somebody else, a neighbor, get a vehicle off the road. And I guess he wasn't in the vehicle. He wasn't in the snowcat at the time, probably doing something to attach the vehicle or tow strap or something. And how I understand it, the snowcat ran over his leg. And this is this is a like a tank. It's like a it's a big tractor. Ran over his leg and somehow hurt part of his chest. But he put an Instagram post up yesterday. So we're in the studio Wednesday. So Tuesday, he put a post up, very short, just a picture of himself saying he's still here. And he's going to take a little break from social media as he tries to heal up. But he's there, and he said thanks for the outpour of comments and prayers and stuff. But yeah, just crazy. And I will also say, Ken Block has three kids, and his daughter Leah, that's really been doing quite a bit on social media and driving and a lot with her dad, and did the YouTube video stuff, the drag race videos. She seemed like a sweetheart of a girl. They built a Fox Body Mustang together, which I thought was fantastic. That was fun. And she's working on the Audi that they just did. This morning she put up an Instagram post, and it was a very heartfelt, sincere, well spoken, well written note about her dad. So, I'm sure there's a lot to unpack over there. There's a lot that's going on. Listen, Ken Block wasn't, he's a young guy. He's got a hell of a lot more going with him. I mean, you see his posts a couple of days ago, and he was literally posting the snowmobiles outside with snow covered on them. And he's like, we're getting on these things, today, which is not, this is what he did all the time. So,
way of life.
Yeah.
That's how he lived his life.
Anyway, just like you said, a tragic start to 2023. Let's hope everything starts turning around and getting better. And I've got a lot of faith and enthusiasm for 2023. So here we go. Let's get into it. Let's turn the page, I guess. Yeah. So the garage, Goldberg's garage. It's there. It's basically done. It's very close to being done. I know you've got to get that foundation poured around the building because of last we talked about it, get the cars in, and it's like a 6-inch slab or something that you're trying to get the car. But so you got to do the
13-inch differential. So I had to build ramps, and it's just precarious and sketchy and stupid. But at the end of the day, all of the cars but three that are strewn throughout the property as I'm looking at the 73 Trans Am sitting right outside. But we're almost there, dude. They poured curbs last week, cleaned them up, raised up the foundation. So now it's only a 3-inch differential. So all of the asphalt and concrete will be poured next week. And then once I get a fence around the damn thing, we'll be pretty much finished. I mean, we're like 95% finished. There's car wash details, trim and stuff, and lev rack needs to come out. But we're there, dude. We're almost there. Gage has been using the gym for the last week with, three to five of his teammates. So it's immediately serving the purpose that I wanted it to serve. The only issue, I got an interesting phone call yesterday. My GC calls and asks if I'm at the garage, and I said no. And he says, well, the landscaper's up there, and there's an animal in there eating your jade tree or whatever the hell it was. I went up there, and we had like a 300-pound deer eating my freaking new plants. But yeah, I got to electrify that fence and come up with some kind of remedy. But
close the doors.
The doors is not the problem. The doors, if I get a longhorn going up up against that building and, slapping its horns, it's just gonna ruin everything. So it's all good. I just got to keep part of the wildlife out. But we're there, dude. We're there. I'm actually using it. I'm enjoying it. I'm still cleaning and moving stuff around. I haven't hung one thing on the walls yet, but
it'll take a little bit to get settled in. You might want to put some stuff up, and then you realize you're going to move it to a different corner or something else.
You should see how many times I've moved the gym equipment. Oh my God. I'll do a set and I'll sit down and I'll look and I'll go, that looks better over here. So
I did it in my kind of small gym that you saw. I did it a few times, but the pain in the ass for me was every time I wanted to move a piece of equipment, it was the one like full rack system with the stack weights on it and everything. So
oh, yeah.
It was like the heaviest piece that you couldn't move. It's a 1,000-pound piece of equipment. So I'm taking the forklift that you can't get underneath it. So I'm trying to use like ratchet straps. I figured out a way now to use the forklift and some ratchet straps, and I get it off the ground. It's not perfectly level, so when you get it off the ground, it kind of leans back, it kind of tilts back, and it's kind of hanging on the ratchet straps. But you can move it around, like you can kind of drag it, like it's almost like it's dragging on its tippy toes, and then you can kind of lower it. Like there is a way to move it around with the forklift, but yeah, that was the one piece I had to move like four times.
Move any of those pieces of equipment with the forklift is put each of them on a pallet.
It is, but I was already set. Like I you're right. Like I kind of envisioned every piece of equipment on pallets, sitting on pallets for like a month. So if you want to, even if you're working out, so you, as you're moving stuff around a little bit, you can be like, oh, I'm going to move it here. And then finally, when you think you got it, then, you know, take all the pallets out. But
well, yeah, I put so there's a little bit of cardio in my gym, right? So there's a treadmill and then there's a rope machine.
Yeah.
So, but facing the opposite direction at the opposite side of my gym as the giant TV on the one wall. So, you know, I wanted to watch the game the other night. And so I turned the rope around so I could see the TV all the way at the other side. And I'm like, you know what? Fuck that. I'm just turning it around and I'm going to buy a TV and I'm going to put it on this wall. So, yeah, I mean, and now the TV gets here and it's too big. So now I'm going to change it with the TV in my kitchen. And it's just one thing after. All good. But we're at the point where it's fun. You know, I'm at the point where I'm going to put the first vehicle on the bend pack, the two post, get it up in the air, get some wheels and tires changed out, and just start going from vehicle to vehicle. Car wash, like I said, is almost done. I'm just having a problem with the Wong system, it leaking. And Milwaukee, thank you guys so much. I continue to get box after box of tools, and I will displaying them. I'll be displaying them once I get a clean workbench from Badass Workbenches, I might add. But yeah, everything's just on top of everything else. So
I was going to ask about the tools. I know you reached out to Milwaukee. You had a relationship with them from years ago. As you start to lay out where the cars are going to be, there's cars that are storage and some that are just sort of display. But have you figured out like a work area? I know you like to tool 100%. Around on the cars a bit. And then because I went through this too, I was like, well, are my tools too far away from where my work car is, like whatever project I'm working on?
And what my solution to that was 14 garage doors and two, and but the center to work, the center of the structure is solely a work bay. Okay, so there's a scissor lift in one bay, and then there's the Benpack two post, you know, 14,000-pound capacity in the other bay, and then the workbench is right in front of it. So literally, the entire middle of the structure is the work area. So on either side, I'll be displaying vehicles, whether it's, you know, the race cars on one side or whether it's all Dodges on the other. But when I need to work on something, I'll just pull it right in the middle. I'm not taking anything to vehicles. I'm taking vehicles to the area.
Right. Okay. Unless you get jammed up like me and your car is on jack stands for 5 years.
That won't happen. Not in the garage. What's going to happen is I'm going to put a two post outside. So if anything is in that state, then that's where that's going to go. Or I just store it in the wash bay. You know, that's kind of my go-to. If I need some storage completely out of the way, just won't use the wash bay for a month and just put the car in there.
Yeah. Okay.
Expo lights it up really well. So I could do any work in there I need to, but
and then,
we're there.
And then the next question, and this is a question on behalf of all of our podcast listeners. When do we get that podcast studio up and running?
You know what? First and foremost, remember all the equipment that I asked you?
Yeah.
That's still in boxes.
Okay.
I have to see if it's worth even unboxing and using. But the issue that I have right now, I did a voiceover for the University of Georgia the other day.
I heard it.
Peach Bowl game. And I ended up doing it in my bathroom closet. Because it's got concrete floor still in my office. And so it echoes like nobody's freaking business.
Yeah, okay.
So once I get the flooring in, it'll change exponentially.
Put some of that gym flooring in there. Thick rubber mat.
Yeah, I mean, that'll absorb it for sure. Yeah. I don't know about the look of it in there, but
yeah, no, it'll
come up with something. It's a small area. I'm going to come up with something and then we'll be there. But like I said, I'm curious to see if that equipment that I have is still even worth unboxing, or is it obsolete, you know, it coming out 3 years ago.
Yeah, well, we'll reach out to Chris. You can even FaceTime with him and go through it. But the carpet in here in this studio, we use the carpet square, so it's almost like tile. So it's easy to put down, and then as one gets screwed up, you can kind of replace it and do it. And then you saw the walls and everything that we did in here, and I know you talked to Chris a little bit about it.
But, yeah, I want to see the carpet.
Yeah, I'll show you. There's different colors, so we've got like a red trim around the outside and kind of a dark bluish, gray blue carpet.
Is it more of a commercial thinness in the carpet?
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah. And
but it absorbs sound pretty well.
I mean, yeah. I mean, once the studio is done, it's great in here. So I don't know what else is underneath it. I guess I can ask Adam when he comes in a little bit and see what he puts down underneath it. But the whole thing was, this whole room is built, raised a little bit. I think there's wires underneath the floor.
Mm-hmm.
I think that's how they did it. That's how I think this all comes up. Chris would know, and Adam, of course, would know. But
And then you talk about the dedicated workspace area, and you talk about things that we still need to do. Well, after the concrete gets laid, then we're pulling every one of the vehicles out, and then the HVAC needs to be turned on for the first time, which is going to blow fiberglass and everything that's in that system out everywhere on the floor of the garage. That's why I got to get the cars out so we can get the thing airtight and climate controlled. But the next step, and pretty much the final step, is the main floor flooring. And so, as I said, I'm going to do pretty much a Nitto commercial and and lay rubber down all in that structure, and then they're going to clear it. The issue with that is that the workbench and the weight of that workbench, and it's in three pieces.
Yeah.
So, and I have to tie in water behind a part of the workbench to connect with the sink system that's in the workbench. Well, I can't do all of that until the floor is done, because I have to remove the workbench and everything else from the floor so that it can be coated.
Yeah.
So I got to do it all in sections. And it's not like that workbench is like 20 pounds. I mean, the thing's
it's massive.
It's freaking huge. So, you know, then there's that. So just a lot of repositioning over the next one.
But as you said, it's mostly there. It's just figuring out the interior stuff. The structure's up. It's good. It's done. The doors close. It's, as far as we know, it's weather resistant.
All the windows are finally in.
Yeah.
Everything's freaking done pretty much. I mean, the big task is laying the concrete and the asphalt, and then we're there, dude. I mean, we're literally there.
And so when do you start rolling out some content around this thing? Like, when do we start to get to see maybe some YouTube stuff, or some social media stuff, get some more videos done?
My goal was Christmas time. My goal was to bring it out, you know, hey, 2023, Goldberg's Garage, finally,
yeah.
You know, after 115 years of construction. But, you know, it's just.
Well, look, I mean, shoot something, do an intro, explain what it is for those on YouTube that don't listen to the podcast, and roll it out in steps, you know, just because there's some cool stuff. I know we got teasers of some of the time-lapse stuff, and you and I texted a few photos and stuff. So it's going to be a work in progress, you know, for a while. I mean, honestly, you know, 6 more months of just laying things out and configuring and stuff and moving stuff around. And even when the cars are laid out, you might want to move them around a little bit because you like, you know, one in a different place than the other, or something's going on and you're going to use it or whatever. So, yeah. So now we're all kind of excited to see the finish, you know, from the renderings to what it ended up being. And, you and I personally have talked about the staircase for a while. I have not seen it yet, so I want to see the stairs.
and the stairs are great, right? As we're speaking, all of the railings are being finished on the stairs because all the railings in the entire structure were done other than the stairs. The problem with the railings on the stairs is that I need to lose weight because the width, it's 35 inches from post to post.
Yeah.
That's not a lot of room. That's really not a lot of room. So you're going to have to be going single file up and down the staircase.
Yeah.
So it's beautiful. It's absolutely appealing to the eye, but it's just a little small. Give me like 6 inches width and I'm fantastic. But hey, I'm not going to bitch and moan over little details.
Yeah, so it'll work out. You'll get used to it. You'll get used to it pretty quickly. Good.
I'm just waiting. Remember Big Boy, the big longhorn that died here on the property?
Yeah.
For Christmas or in Hanukkah, Wanda got me his horns, right?
Yeah.
And so I've got this rack that's freaking huge, and it's the first thing that's going to be hung in the garage. I'm going to do that on an Instagram video. And the horns mean a lot to me, and it means a lot to the property, and it'll be the way to christen the garage.
Yeah. All right.
So I'm looking forward to that.
All right. Well, sounds good. let's see what else is going on. I did a little road trip over the holiday break. I went from California to Phoenix to Sedona to Vegas to back to California. And I wanted to do a little bit of off-roading, and finding a vehicle to do it in. Naturally, my F-150 Lightning is not the vehicle for that. I get it. It's electric vehicles. It's not a road trip vehicle, especially over the holidays, by the way. When I was driving and I saw like charging stations or Tesla stations, they were completely full. There was a line of people. It looked miserable, and I feel for them who have to do that on a road trip. I say just rent yourself like a Chevy Tahoe or something. Tammy was coming with me. The little dogs were coming with me. We wanted plenty of room, and we wanted a nice ride, and I wanted to try something that we haven't tried before. So I reached out to Lexus and grabbed the LX600. Which is basically the Toyota Land Cruiser, right? So I knew that you were going to get a comfortable ride, but I wanted some off-road capability because we were going to try to hit the dirt a little bit. And actually, it worked out well. So we got the LX 600 Ultra Luxury. The Ultra Luxury is... This one was a little bit different configuration. It's not going to be the most popular configuration because you can get a 3-row version of this thing or whatever, their premium model. But this one is it tipped the scales, if you will, on price. It comes in about $127,000, but the back seat is 2 captain's chairs with a fixed center console with cup holders and plugs, and the passenger side rear seat, if no one's in the front, that becomes a recliner. It's like a full massage, full recliner. So what I was doing is I was driving and I told Tammy, I was like, well, sit in the back and try it out. So her sitting in the back passenger side allows you to take the front passenger seat. It moves forward. It's designed to move forward and kind of lean forward, and the headrest folds down or whatever. And it's got flat screens on the back, and the rear seat allows you to recline, put your feet up. It's like a luxury jetliner, right? And you've got a touchscreen next to you, and there's TVs back there, screens, and there's headphones you can listen to stuff, and you get a massage chair, and the dogs just basically sit in the passenger's chair over there, and they're reclined, and they got seat warmers on, so they're just napping the whole time. So what Lexus has been able to do now is upscale the Land Cruiser experience. I don't even think we have a Land Cruiser anymore. And it was fantastic. Now, this ultra luxury, this four-seat configuration is not as practical. If you're a black car driver, limo driver, whatever, this is probably the configuration you want. Or if you're a hotel in Vegas or a studio out here in LA and you're driving, somebody around, like that's maybe the configuration that you want. But you can get conventional seats. You can get a third row seat. So there was plenty of storage for the bags. It was absolutely comfortable driving out there. And this particular version, of course, has the active air ride suspension. It has its full off-road capabilities. These trucks are still built on a full frame instead of a unibody platform. So it was very strong, but Lexus has done a pretty good job of eliminating that truck feeling from it. It really doesn't feel like a truck anymore. So I was thinking, what about its off-road capabilities? Will it still do it? So we got to Phoenix. We drove around there, did stuff with the family, and then I was like, let's go to Sedona. And I said, I want to find someplace off-road. Let's go for a hike. And Tammy found a great location. I forgot what it was called. And you have two options. You can get there and park in a parking lot and then hike about a mile. You walk about a mile to get to the hiking trail and you go up the mountains or whatever. Or that mile, if you have an off-road vehicle, you can take your off-road vehicle. And right at the front gate of that mile run, it's a pretty big kind of rock structure that's there, and it's meant to be like the test, right? What they didn't want was like
– you can make it the rest of the mile.
That's exactly what it was. So it's intimidating when you see it and you're like, oh, this is a little bit bigger than you think it would be. And it was interesting. So there was a few people around us. There was – definitely a few Jeeps. Most of them were a little lifted more than stock. F-150 4x4 had a lift kit on it, and a handful of the UTVs, the Razors or whatever, four passenger ones. There's a place that you can rent them. So if you want, you can just kind of rent them and do a little bit of off-roading and stuff. And I just told Tammy, I was like, it's fine. Let's put this in the off-road mode. Let's raise up the air suspension. Let's go over that first obstacle, which we did. And we started doing it. And then everybody was looking at us because it's a brand new, really nice $130,000 SUV.
Who's this dumbass?
Yeah. And everyone's looking at us like a bunch of douches. And, most people probably not knowing that this is an off-road vehicle. This was based off of the Land Cruiser, which is a great off-road vehicle. I mean, I think you'd get the same looks if you were, in a brand new Range Rover, which is also a very capable off-road vehicle, right? And the Defender. I saw one guy out there in like a 15-year-old Mercedes ML. And and he got quite a ways down and he was just like, nope, I'm done. And turned it around and went back. I don't know if he just got embarrassed by the dirty looks or just kind of felt like he was bottoming out a little bit on some of the rocks. But honestly, the Lexus was flawless. And, you know, we grabbed some pictures, we grabbed some video. For those of you guys that have a lot more experience in off-roading and overlanding and doing all that great stuff, far more than I do. I just, you know, being in Venice, Santa Monica area, I just don't get out and do much of it. We definitely got that, whatever you want to call it, right? Whatever, I don't know what the feeling is or the experience is that you want to call it. I'm sure the overlanding community has a term for it, but we're in the vehicle and we're seeing these rock structures and we're driving up them and the truck's pointing up and you can't see and it's pointing down and it looks like it's a huge, you know, dip in the road and you're kind of leaning off to the left and leaning off to the right. And then I was like, oh, this is insane. Like, this thing is just, you know, off-roading and we're climbing and it's doing it. And I was like, Tammy, jump out, grab some video. This got to be gnarly. She gets out, films it, gets back in. She goes, that was boring as fuck. And she goes, so whatever's happening inside the vehicle feels way more intense than what it looks like outside of the vehicle. She's like, it looks like you're just driving in the dirt. And I was like, all right, well, inside the vehicle, it's going, you know, it's like a roller coaster ride. So whatever.
That's, you should have taken the video from the inside of the vehicle.
Yeah. So we got a little bit of from the inside of the vehicle and I'll put it all up on social media. But it's going to be underwhelming because you're going to just see the vehicle just like move forward. And then you don't realize, you know, you're going slow and, you know, it feels like the truck's pointing up and the truck's pointing down and leans left, right, and whatever. And outside of the vehicle, it just looks like it's crawling over like a couple of curbs or something like that. So the video is not impressive, but the experience absolutely was, and it was fun. And then we drove it to Vegas and we were, you know, we just parked it there and hung out in Vegas for New Year's. And it was a blast. We met up with some friends from Canada that drove their big motorhome down, and don't be shocked, but my friend from Canada is like a huge Fox Body Mustang collector. And that's how we know each other. We actually met at Barrett Jackson years ago.
Speaking of which, I'll be there in 3 weeks.
Yeah. Yeah, so we hung out. We had a great time. And then he drove back down. A typical car guy. He's like, oh, I'm going to drive back to Canada. I need to make a quick stop in Orange County in California, pick up some wheels for another car project, and then I'm going to go. And I was like, all right, it's a nice little detour. But I'll tell you, we didn't leave Sunday, like January 1st. We left Monday the 2nd thinking we'd beat some of the traffic. No. We did not. What a fucking shit show trying to drive back. It really didn't matter what time of day, but between the traffic and the stupid accidents and it's just people not paying attention. I mean, I'm saying stupid accidents. Nothing tragic, nothing, just fender benders of people not paying attention because they're texting or you know, sitting in traffic and they're bored. But just causes massive delays. I don't know. What's the ride from Vegas to LA? 4.5 hours, 4 hours, something like that. It took 9 hours.
Not surprising.
Nine hours. Like, it was, and rain and just, it was just miserable. Like, it was 12 miles an hour. It just seemed like we were going 12 miles an hour the whole time. Play.
We can't talk about traffic and we can't talk about driving up there with, and not speak about that Tesla that flew off of the 101.
Yeah.
And all four of them freaking survived after it rolled down there.
Yeah. I saw pictures of it, but I didn't really get into what happened. But
well, now they're saying that it was on purpose, that the guy driving is a doctor and he tried to kill his family. There were two kids in the vehicle, and you know, he went off of PCH and it was down in a can or a ravine or something, and just a rock ravine, and pull it up online, the car's destroyed.
Yeah,
and
I saw the picture,
and the four people survived. I couldn't believe it.
Wow. Yeah, amazing. I'm telling you, like, I the weather we had on that ride back, the rain and everything, I was like, it just wasn't worth it to do. We should have just stayed an extra day or two, or drove back on a Tuesday or something. Just kind of, you know, just. But I had to get back and I had shit to do. But yeah, don't do that drive, especially during a holiday weekend. Don't do that drive. But anyway, that was a
miserable.
Yeah, miserable kind of thing. Anyway, what else is going on? Ford's been moving forward on the next generation F-150 Lightning, which is will come out in 2025. There'll be a little crossover. They'll sell the current one for a few months while they roll the new one. So probably mid-year, maybe fall of 2025, they'll start production, get delivery toward the end of the year. And the phase out the current one.
Yep.
I don't know. Like, I like my truck a lot. It's very comfortable. It's nice to drive. It's probably still a little bigger than what I need for LA. I still find, you know, the parking garages I don't fit in, and parking spots. It's a little, you know, when parking is a premium and it's hard to find, and you know, so it's. It's an adjustment to own a vehicle like that in LA. And I'm always down to try new things. So I don't know how long I would keep it or if I would get something new. But, you know, as we start to go into this EV world.
You start to go into
yeah.
EV world.
Well,
me and another part of these listeners are just watching you guys and laughing and
yeah,
just waiting. Shit to happen, man, because I ain't a fan. I'm just going to come out and say it in 2023, and it's not going to freaking happen. And I know you're not the biggest fan in the world, but let in 2023, let's look at reality, okay? Let's look at infrastructure. Let's look at all of the things that are positives for electric cars and peel back the onion a little bit.
Yeah.
Right? So this shit ain't going nowhere. Not yet.
No.
It will in a number of years, but right now it's a freaking pipe dream.
I agree. I mean, I like the truck. I like not having to go to a gas station. I just go to my warehouse and I plug it in when I need to plug it in. But there are definite limitations. You know, I've run out of range. I don't want to say battery because, you know, I still stopped and charged it, but it was like, you know, I did it in the pouring rain, you know, when Adam and I went out to an event and, you know, it was 2 o'clock in the morning and it's just pouring rain. And I got to stop for 30 minutes at a fast charger to get an extra fucking 60 miles of range so I can, you know, get it. You know, it's not ideal.
The parts of the country that are cold all the time. What does that do to the batteries? What does that do to the charge? What does that do to the charging time? What does that do to the capacity?
Yes, listen, I've been following some of the F-150 forum guys and Twitter and the preconditioning of batteries and all of this stuff. So,
waste of freaking time. Absolute waste of fucking time.
Yes, except I wanted to be able to experience it, then come back and talk about it. And,
yeah, absolutely.
And would I trade my gas engine cars for an electric vehicle and have that be the only thing I drive? I'm definitely not ready for that. Ready for that. As nice as the truck is, I like it more because it's a really nice F-150 Platinum and it's got, you know, it's a really nice truck. Not necessarily because it's electric. It's just a really nice truck that happens to be quiet. And fast, and that experience is interesting. But, you know, having, you know, the old school Raptor, you know, V8 with the Roush supercharger on it, which I drove as well, way fun, super fun. So,
and don't get me wrong, man. At the start of 2023, I'm not sitting here, you know, saying that electric cars are a bad idea. I'm just saying the timing is not right. So everybody jump off your freaking bandwagon and understand the reality of the infrastructure of the United States. And then sit back and make an assumption of whether in the next 5 years it's truly going to happen.
Right. Because
it's not. It's not going to happen. I'm sorry. Everybody can pipe dream it all they want. And every politician can push for it, you know, all they want. And it's not going to happen. And at the end of the day, it's truly doesn't save the environment like everybody's saying it does, you know. So not to the point that they say it. And so for me, I think it's a waste of fucking time. I do.
Right. There's
I love the earth and I want to do everything I can to help. Hey, I have a kid. Right. And I want, you know, future generations to prosper and have as much fun and, you know, to be able to do everything and, you know, have the freedom. But we have to be realistic. That's all.
We definitely have some work to do. Yeah.
I mean, if you didn't own one, you'd be. You wouldn't have to cover your purchase, is what I'm saying, right? The downfalls that you've experienced, it was an experiment, right?
Yeah.
It was an experiment.
Yeah, it's an experiment.
So I think you'd be even more harsh on the situation if you didn't own one.
I agree. And you know, but I wanted these conversations, and for the sake of these conversations and the fact that I have other gas engine vehicles, I'm a little interested in maybe down the road trying a different electric vehicle, something maybe longer range and a little bit more, you know, size appropriate for LA, and see what that experience is like. But at this point, it's like, I don't know. I'm not really doing too much. I'm just trying to get the tune done in the Mach 1 so I can start driving the twin turbo car around.
Exactly.
You know, and we're still kind of fussing around with that. So I just want to get that. But in the meantime, like, it's pouring rain out here and we got shit weather. So I'm like, all right, I got a little bit of time, you know, because I'm running that on summer tires. And, you know, at least the F-150 is, you know, it's all-wheel drive and it's on all-weather tires. So driving out here in the rain, I was like, well, I guess I'm going to drive it. This is the right time to drive it. But anyway. Like I said,
again, don't get me wrong, man. I'm not completely against this revolution. I'm just saying that the timing, it's not realistic. And anybody who thinks it is they're a moron. I'm just saying.
Right. Well, because it's not an only car, I am interested in something of a performance vehicle, an electric performance vehicle, because what the electrification can do to the performance of the vehicle is super interesting to me.
That's not a vehicle you're really worrying about the range in.
Right, 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 right. So I'm a little bit interested in that, but all right, we're going to wrap things up. Listen, we got a lot more down the road. Speaking of electric, we'll get into this later. I drove the Mercedes EQS 580. This is the all-electric Mercedes SUV, and it's the larger one. And very interesting. A heck of a learning curve. I mean, the tech in this thing is just off the charts. So we'll get into it. We'll get into that a little bit more. That deserves a little bit more time. But
I also cannot wait to get into an electric performance vehicle.
Yeah,
but when the time is right.
Yeah, when the time is right.
Because I don't like inconvenience.
Yeah,
you know, and there's nothing but inconvenience with these electric vehicles at this point.
Yes, but there is a little bit of convenience. Like I said, I don't go to a gas station anymore.
Well, I don't either because I have gas in my fucking garage.
Yeah, right.
Right? So.
Right. But in this instance, you would have a charger as well. And you can, you know, like you said, roll it into the garage or maybe just into the wash bay or something and just be like, I'm just going to park, you know, maybe not put a charger in the wash bay, but like just outside of it.
The right place.
Probably not the right place to put it. But,
I'd like to try one. I'd like to do a case study like you did, but yeah. You know, quite obviously, and having other type of vehicles to drive.
Right. Know, when, But listen, I'm interested in what the car companies are doing. I'm interested in Porsche, what they're doing with EVs, possibly 911s and Macan and Cayman and
how about Audi?
Yeah, what Audi's doing on stuff as well. So there's some interesting things there. And I asked Ford. I drove the Mustang Mach-E, and I asked them for the GT Performance. That thing's quick. The range isn't really there, but I want to drive the fast version of that thing. I've driven a few of the Mach-Es, but not the fully, you know, the full tilt version of it. So, you know, we're going to get into that as well. But it's funny because Ford reached out twice in the last like month. They're like, "Hey, we've got a Lightning in if you want to test drive it." I go, "Oh, thanks. I already bought one." And then yesterday he reached out and he's like, "All right, we got the 2022 Mach 1s if you want to drive that." I was like, "Oh, thanks. I already bought one." And he wrote back. He's like, "I should be getting my test cars from you." And I was like, "Yeah." It's like I got early enough on the list that I got early versions of both of those cars. So before all the fleet guys got it here in California for Ford. But all right, we got to give the studio up. We got to do another podcast in here. But thanks, guys. Appreciate it. We'll see you next week. Until next time, keep the air and the spare in the bag of the week.
For the latest updates and call-in times, follow the show on Facebook, Twitter, and Instagram at CarCast Show. If you'd like to write in, fill out the form on CarCastShow.com. And don't forget to give us a nice rating on iTunes. CarCast is a Corolla Digital production and is produced by Chris Loxamana. For more information, visit CarCastShow.com.
You know, I got to tell you, I have so many garbage apps on my phone, I never know where to look for stuff. And recently, I decided to clean house. All the junk and clutter gone. This leaves me with my most cherished apps. You know, the ones that can do it all. Like my Live One app. Music, events, news, podcasts, comedy. Oh, and actual musical stations curated by humans, not those robots hanging out on Bezos' yacht. All this on one tiny little place on my phone. I've become such a fan of the app, we here at the Adam Carolla Show will give you 3 months free. Jump on to liveone.com/Carolla to lock in your deal today. And with inflation at an all-time high, this is a huge savings. liveone.com/Carolla for 3 months plus for free. No ads.
All month long on Pluto TV, stream the biggest Tyler Perry movies free. Watch your favorites like Madea's Witness Protection and Madea's Big Happy Family. Join Tyler Perry as he goes on a couples retreat with Sharon Leal in Why Did I Get Married? Or Idris Elba and Gabrielle Union in the Tyler Perry-directed film Daddy's Little Girls. Plus, Pluto TV has hundreds of channels with thousands more movies and TV shows available on live and on demand. Download the free Pluto TV app on all your favorite devices and start streaming now. Pluto TV. Drop in, watch free.